We're recording?
All right. Hey, everybody. It's Mark Oakley again with another episode of From the Valley. And today we have our shit together. It's so great. All the technical issues are, you know, worked out, knock on wood. And that means I can start inviting on top tier talent, man. And cut the camera to Sahara Jane, please. This is one of the most fabulous women in the valley.
Oh, come on. Don't make me blush right off.
She is a world traveler, and she is a just primo musician and just a sparkling personality, and I love her to bits, and I'm just really, really glad to have you on. And with that out of the way, how are you doing?
I'm good. This is a very cool place.
It's a pretty sweet spot.
It's awesome. You know? It's awesome. I'm really happy to be here and to have a chat with you, because it's been a while since I found you somewhere and we sat down and had a conversation about something.
We seem to run, whenever I run into you, it's like sparky, man. It's just like, whoa, who's this woman, man? Because there's, you know.
And then we have these like intense conversations that go on and on and on and on. And then I feel like I did something today.
Yeah. I feel like
I had a conversation with Mark.
You know?
Yeah.
So where are you in the world these days? I know you're in Kentville now, right?
Yeah.
And you have a house, which seems really unlike you.
Yes. It's a whole new world. It's kind of like the world that I read about in books or like talked to other people. And it was always like, that's really fascinating and very foreign. And so now I've kind of dipped my toes in.
Do you have like furniture?
Yeah, a couch.
You have a whole couch?
Well, it's not like a whole couch. It's like a love seat.
Okay,
so the house is small. It's an A-frame. Uh-huh. It suits us perfectly because it's all one room and it's very low maintenance. Like everything, you know what I mean? If something in the plumbing goes, you just sort of open the cupboard and you can see all the things. And it's just like everything is clean and easy.
Is it a new house or?
Yes. Oh, yes. Nice. Yeah. Yes. It was built by my sister's partner.
No way. Mm-hmm. That's handy too. You can just sort of get on the road. Dude, your plumbing's busted. Get over here.
No, they're in Montreal now.
Oh, that's a hard.
But they did, sell us the house. So now we have a house. And so then there's been like landscaping, and I didn't know that I was a gardener, but now I'm like planting things. Mostly, it's not a lot of light, but there's a lot of, Camila, before she left that house, she planted a bunch of fruit trees. So there's just this sort of luscious.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we've been building up the garden, putting in paths and making it beautiful. And now it feels like this magical space to just sit. And the house is very simple. The whole front is just a
like
metal
when you say an A-frame, it's literally a triangle.
It's a complete triangle. It's a perfect triangle.
All right.
And there's like no windows. There's nothing in the front. So all you see from the front is like a metal roof, metal-colored roof, yeah.
Hmm. You're going to stay there for a while, I think? Or?
Well, yeah. And the nice thing about it is because we are musicians, we can leave and sort of lock the door and it's fine. Like, it's not basements and all that stuff. There's no basement. There's nothing to really...
Basements are not designed for Nova Scotia.
Yeah.
They're like crispers, you know, like, you know, in the fridge where you sort of, it's the rotter. It's
the place you don't want to open after a while, yeah.
God, yeah.
Yeah, so we don't have that. So we really love that place because it means we can kind of come and go. And now that we are really, like everyone else, grounded, it's so good to have a place to live. Had this all happened, this COVID stuff, 2 years ago?
Where were you when COVID landed?
I was in India.
Okay.
And me and Ken were in India together. And we just started feeling the energy that people were starting to get nervous about. This, it hadn't hit India really, but we knew about it from China. And when I started feeling people get nervous is when I started thinking, okay, I think we should change our tickets and come back a bit earlier.
What month were you, were your antenna tingling there?
February.
Okay.
And by March, like we were supposed to come home in April, but we changed the ticket to come home March 12th. And because we did it early enough, we were able to change it with no major fee, no major problem.
Oh, good, yeah.
We got a ticket, and then it became everybody changing tickets all over the world, and you couldn't, you know, flights were getting canceled and all that stuff. So we actually made it just before everything just kind of broke down and it became hard. So yeah, I'm glad we came back. I also feel like, I feel like it's been really hard on my friends in Mumbai and especially in the cities, you know.
What are they experiencing over in India? I mean,
a lot of just lockdown, like being
like are they like Australian tackle people and shove faces on or masks on their faces level lockdown, or is it like what's the level of draconian
I don't know exactly for everybody because I don't know all the regions, yeah. but I do know that, I mean, I know people who have not yeah. left their houses in months, you know, and you can, I mean, people can, there's still delivery and things happening, but people are not really entering each other's houses. It's been pretty major, like pretty.
We've had it pretty gentle here, haven't we? I mean,
in Nova Scotia,
I feel like Nova Scotia is its own bubble and, yeah. and Nova Scotians, like, I can't say all of them, but a good portion of them, they know it's bullshit. They're just like, whatever. It's all for theater. They put the, and they're good. They put the masks on. I was just at, like, you know, Staples today buying a hard drive, and I was the only guy who was being a bit of a dick. I'm just like, I'm not going to give myself brain damage. I don't want to rebreathe my CO2. So I have the mask on, but I have my nose prominently sticking out, just daring someone to sort of, sir, your nose. How do you address that? Like, sir, your nose is protruding.
I don't even think they are. I think it's sort of. I mean, I don't think that the stores and stuff are taking that kind of level. They're just, it's all recommended and people have to, you know, choose.
Yeah, I think we're told, like, am I hearing like an alarm out there? It's really bugging me.
Mm. Yeah, do you want?
Are you coming outside reversing?
There's nothing we can really do about it. Is it being picked up on the audio here?
I don't think so.
Great. Okay, great. We'll just ignore it. Yeah. But, well, they say, like, well, it's recommended, it's not enforced, and you're not allowed to ask someone why they don't want to wear a mask because that's invasion of privacy. Like, mm-hmm. what if you have, like, you're like, I'm a shy asthmatic, you know?
Yeah.
So, anyway.
Yeah.
But, no, I feel like Nova Scotia kind of got a break, you know? We're...
Well, we always have a break in that we are so connected to nature here.
Mm.
We have places we can walk, you know, even if we don't have cars or whatever, we can... get around, we can go breathe fresh air and be around trees, and you know, I'm just so grateful for it. And especially when everything was really locked down,
yeah,
and you couldn't even walk in the parks, and that was frustrating.
Oh yeah.
Like, oh, but where we live, we are on these sort of back trails that just go forever, so yeah, there's still places to.
I remember in spring going to a park, and I'm gonna sit at a picnic table and I'm gonna draw stuff, and seeing like the playground equipment with like yellow emergency tape around
it's
it,
like heartbreaking.
And at that point, no one really knew, but some of the numbers are coming out, and the people who were analyzing this stuff are going, this isn't what they say it is.
Yeah.
And it takes forever for people to catch up, and then it kind of divides into like the cult of the believers and the, you know, those who are just like, whatever, you know, but I've lost friends over this, you know, it's like, it's just, you know.
And I feel like that's happening anyway. People are losing friends over everything, over every little issue and every disagreement or every people getting different information and then really attaching to it.
You know?
It's a strange time.
Yeah. But it's funny that you mentioned, that your antenna went up a little earlier and you're able to get your plane tickets changed.
Well, I've been going back and forth to India for many years now, and I feel like when people start in a city like Mumbai, you know, when things go crazy, they go crazy.
It's dense, man.
A lot of people, and you don't really want to be the foreigner in the midst of a crisis, because it's like I feel like people in Mumbai actually really support each other through things like floods and through things like I don't know, like political unrest. Like, people are pretty careful with each other, actually, in that city. I really love that city for that.
Hmm.
It's a pretty strong place.
Have you been to other parts of India?
Like, yeah.
So how does Mumbai compare to like Delhi?
Well, this is going on the internet, and I don't want to ever, you know, I'm aware that those two cities have a kind of, those
I did not know that. I just picked that out of the blue. Yeah.
I don't know if it's a rivalry, but people in Mumbai don't really understand people in Delhi, people in Delhi vice versa, because the cultures are so different.
Oh, is that right?
And certainly the feeling for women is quite different.
Oh.
They come from different cultural spaces, really, even though they're both, you know, technically North India, but
like, what are some of the differences that I without stepping on any landmines, can you just sort of give me is it like arranged marriages, is that part of it, or is it
no, it's not even, I mean, because that kind of thing happens within every city. There's all, I mean, we consider Canada a multicultural country,
yeah,
and people don't understand the depth to which India is a multicultural country as well. Like, yeah, some families have arranged marriages, some families don't, you know, the women don't get educated or can't play music or something, you know, a neighboring family is from a different, you know, religion, a different background, or even the same religion and language, but completely different cultural.
I guess they had like millennia to sort of mix and figure out different ways of doing things. And
So some in some families, will totally, you know, hair uncovered, and some families hair is covered, and like I mean you can see the major religious lines, but even within the religious lines there's all these sort of class distinctions, and there's just the culture that that each family has has a strong lineage. And so people are constantly in all the cities you'll find all kinds of people. Actually, it's really,
we forget how young North America is. Like, we've got a couple hundred years of history. Oh, that's nice. Ain't that cute, you know?
Our culture, I think, is very it's becoming even more, in my opinion, it's just very influenced by media, by our mass media, maybe since the 50s, or I mean, there was radio, there was television, there was, now there's everything on the internet or whatever. But we're getting so much of the same information constantly as everyone else, and people are kind of aligning with that, with brands and with, you know, I don't know, whatever their favorite shows are or whatever their like style is. It's a different way of culture being born.
When you're aware of and have studied media and how it works and how persuasion works and propaganda, you're still sucked right into it. I mean, it's very hard to sort of surf the top of it and try and maintain some. It's so powerful. Culture, though, the weird digital culture that we've invented in the last 20 years, 30 years or whatever. I mean, it's been around, but the internet's just compressed it. So is India not like that? I mean,
well, that's what I feel like.
Some of the bloggers that I look at are like these little dudes in Indian apartments, and they're just like, you know, go PewDiePie. Just, you know.
Well, yeah, I mean, definitely India has all the media.
Yeah.
All of the internet is wild. Everybody has a cell phone. Like everybody. It's just, it's incredible, because I was there in 2010.
So they're just as thick into it as we are then.
Well, they are, but there's also all this other cultural background sort of informing each person's identity.
Okay.
So it's not just what you're seeing online and what you're seeing on television, but it's also your family traditions and your religious traditions. And there's all this, your culture, like the village you're from. Like, even if you live in the city, you still maybe carry on traditions and culture from a village where your family was originally from. So, and there's a lot of identity there, as opposed to feeling when people are getting more isolated from their actual, you know, human culture interactions, cultural interaction history, they're getting more identified with what they're seeing online or what they're, you know, who their favorite comic strip writer is or whatever. It's like, if you're a Mark Oakley fan, like, that's a thing, right? That's an identity also. But a cool one, I think. But I don't know. I feel like, there's just a lot more at play. So it's not as simple as somebody who's making YouTube videos in India has maybe, is creating a world for themselves and their followers or whatever, but they also have a lot more, a lot more historical influence. Like you say, an older country with an older culture that's still intact.
Yeah.
Because obviously we didn't just land, we didn't just create, North America was not just created, right? There is a long history to people who live here, but they're kind of disconnected from it, right? That's, I think, our difference.
One of the things that I noticed is that whenever I see sort of snippets of Indian culture or India in the media or movies made in India, it's like, oh, they're like, there's almost like a maturity growth curve that you have to go through when, like, this is the invention of the television, and culture has to sort of assimilate that. And once they've done that, then they can move on to the next steps and the next steps. And so you it's almost like looking back in time. Like, I remember there was a documentary about advertising, and there was some Indian village, I don't know where in this massive country or what portion of that huge population it was, but it was a village that had a lot of people, and, you know, might have had running water, no electricity. And so they came in, this soap company, there's like a dish soap company, some American dish soap company came in, and they had elephants, and they were projecting movies on the sides of elephants, and they set up like, you know, and the message was very simple. It was like, this is the best product ever. You can wash your hands, you can wash your detergent, think of it, you know, you'll be, you're a miserable person now. And you're just sort of watching, you know, when you tell a story to a group of kids, they're just like that, a thousand, several thousand people all just, and my buddy was looking, what do you think they're going to do? And I'm going, they're going to buy soap. You know, like, and that was because the media, the company that gone in had 50 years of, you know, well, or I don't know when this was, this might've been the 70s or the 80s or something like this. Mm-hmm. And then you know, fast forward, I was watching a clip from an action film, and it was like sort of, I don't know what kind of budget it had. It had some pretty cool effects, but it had like a machine man. He was magnetic, and he, you know, he walks into a room full of soldiers, and he just holds up a hand, and all the guns fly out of their hands. Now he's got 50 guns, and he's aiming them all, and he's a ball of guns. They're all pointing outward, and he's rolling around and shooting people. Ah! And they're flying off cliffs, and things are exploding. I was looking at it going, this is how a 5-year-old or a 10-year-old would go, and then, you know, and I was like, this, it's cringy, but cool, and it's, oh, they're at that point. I bet if we go back and look at some of the silly things that we made in North American and thought were really cool back in the 70s, like some of our $6 million man, you know, it just, yeah, but.
I just watched one of those, actually.
I mean, the pacing was different, isn't it?
But it gave me the same feeling as what you were describing. I was just like, yeah, this one guy goes and like basically kills everybody in the movie and then walks out the hero, and it's like, what did I watch? Crazy.
There's a lot of stuff that doesn't travel well, but the thing is, I feel like you have to go through these steps. Like if you're growing up and you never learned how to deal with conflict, you just were shielded from it your whole life, then you're in your 30s and you're in a conflict, all you have are the resources you built when you were 10.
Yeah.
You know, and I think everything works that way, and learning how to manage this crazy specter of media is culture that you have to, it's kind of like learning, remember email when it first began and people didn't know how not to have flame wars? It's like, send, and you're like, was that a good idea? You know? Like, but I feel like I feel like I've gotten a lot better at like, wait before you send, it's just easy now. But then, you know, you could destroy families and friendships over friggin' email, you know?
Yeah.
But we had to learn it as a culture. Anyway, I'm just babbling, so.
Well, yeah.
I don't know. How do you find that? Like when you go over there, how would you measure the sort of cultural maturity of Mumbai to, Wolfville?
Okay. I can't answer that on any level, pretty much. But because
I know.
Yeah, but I do feel like what I went to India looking for and what happened, what I discovered there was very different. Because I grew up in Wolfville. Uh-huh. My dad's from Afghanistan, and he had all of this music, you know? And it was like, you know, we were back and forth between my mom's house and my dad's house. So when we went to his house, there was, and even in the car ride, you know, there was just this music that was like nothing else that I heard. And of course, I mean, see, of course, if people know me, they know that my family is very musical. Like music has been a big part of our life. My sisters and I are all
excellent musicians.
My sisters are professional musicians, and like that's what we do. And we grew up really exploring that together. And my mother's a music teacher, and so she get like any concert that came to Wolfville, you know, she would make sure that we found a way to hear it, you know, even though we didn't have a lot of money as a family at that time. She just made sure that like that was always a priority for her, this kind of exposure to music. And then I would be in my dad's car, and it was just something completely different. Like what am I hearing? And there was no reference for it anywhere in my life.
On the radio in
Nova Scotia,
or just from.
Well, it turns out, you know, it was like old tape. It was tapes that, I mean, where did he even get them?
Yeah.
Because at that time, to find Indian music, and I thought it was Afghan music. Some of it was like Afghan folk music that maybe got sent by relatives, or I don't know. But the you know, a lot of it was these sort of burned tapes or tapes of Bollywood music, which is like the pop music of India. I didn't know what it was, but it was so good. Mm-hmm. It was just like, this, I need more of this. And, you know, as a child, I didn't really, it was just sort of this thing that he somehow had, and nobody else even knew what it was. You know, nobody else ever heard it. So.
Oh, wow.
Like,
He was here in Nova Scotia, really a culture of his own. Like, where were the people? Where were the people he could share that with? And where did he even come up with the music? I don't really know. I mean, now I know. Maybe there was an Indian shop in Halifax then, like there is now, where you can still go get, you know, henna for your hair certain spices and all the things. Like, I'm glad that there's
deep and mature arts that were sort of,
I went to India looking for that sound that I had heard. And I went, when I finally got there, I was 26. I mean, I didn't even go to university till I was 25, 26, because I was playing music as a living. And then when I went there, I was still like in search. I went to York University in Toronto because there was an Indian teacher, an Indian professor teaching rhythm. And I just kept meeting people who had studied with him, and they were just like incredible musicians. Whether they played saxophone or drums or whatever, it didn't really matter. His influence was huge, and I could even feel it through people I knew who had learned from him. So I went there for him, really, and took a South Asia studies degree, so I'd learn more about Afghanistan and India. And what I learned there was that nobody, like, there was not much out about Afghanistan at all. Like, even though it was considered South Asia in this group of, you know, Bangladesh and India and Pakistan, Afghanistan was listed, but not explored. Like, there just wasn't, there's not the research, there's not the academic style of research anyway out there. So I learned a lot about India. I ended up going to India in that first year with a professor who introduced me into like the world of Indian music.
How old were you at that point?
I was 26, I guess, you know, and this was like my life goal, but I mean, I didn't know how to bridge that gap. Afghanistan was off limits for various reasons, many obvious reasons.
Yeah.
But the music, my father was like, no, the music you want to hear, like, go to India to learn the music, because that's the music you've been hearing. And like, that's where you'll be able to get a real basis in music. Mm. And when I did end up going there, I was in with a deep classical master. So the music that I ended up learning was very much not the music that I was hearing, but it was the basis of the music I was hearing. Because that stuff, the Bollywood, the pop music from the 60s and 70s in India, which is what my father was listening to, that was all really based in Indian classical music. Okay. So the singers were just highly trained and just like amazing. So if I wanted to even understand that music at all, I had to really study the classical, which happened sort of on its own. I didn't even understand all of that until way later, why I was singing one note for 20 minutes when what I wanted to do was like singing and dancing kind of style. And so, what I ended up learning in India was so deeply, like you're talking about, like cultural maturity.
Like ancient.
It's such a beautiful way for me. So I can talk more about music in India than,
of course,
you know, politics and history and all, although I did learn a lot about that, because actually I studied it, you know, in university before I spent a lot more time there. So anyway, it's been an interesting musical journey. But
when I listen to you play, it's indescribable. Well, I mean, I'm going to try and describe it, but and many people have, but it's, I would you call yourself a master? I know that's a silly question to throw at someone, but I mean, that's when I hear other musicians, I'm like, oh, they're banging drums and playing guitars and they're doing what they think is music, and maybe they get good at it, but you're tapping into something that's so layered and very powerful. I mean, it always makes, I always cry when you play, you know, and it's just like, it just travels through me. And weirdly enough, I haven't hunted it down. I'm always like, that's, it's almost like looking at the sun. I don't go look for tapes or whatever. I go, I'll just go right back to, you know, whatever's on K-Rock, you know, just that sort of thing. But it's like you're touching another level of magic, you know, and
I feel like there is a channel there. Mm. Like what you're feeling is that, I mean, I feel that too. When I feel it, I feel like it's easy for someone else to feel it. And
well, you need someone to guide you. Like, someone like me can't just sort of sit, okay, hit me.
Yeah. And I was in search for that. Like that's why I went to India, is because I would feel that through certain music, but not know how to tap into it myself either. Mm. And I feel like the fact that It's so cool that you say that, because it has started to happen for me too, where in a performance or in a, even in practice, there is like, it's like, I am completely not there anymore. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, because I know what I'm like, I don't have to think, what note am I singing? What word am I singing? How do I want to portray this sentence? Like, these are the things that a songwriter might think, like, okay, yeah. I wrote this really cool thing. How do I really get the motion across?
Right.
You know, but when all of that is not the issue anymore, like I already know all of that, then the next level is something that is just like, it's teaching me in that moment. So I'm not doing anything. I'm just kind of like this channel of this the energy of whatever's available in that particular musical style. So if it's like, sometimes it's in a simple folk song, maybe it's something I wrote or something I learned from someone else, like someone else's song, but there can be this essence that is beyond the music and the melody and the words, you know, it's something that just kind of hits the heart, and it doesn't even really matter. It's not really about exactly what the words were, but there's an essence in that whole creation. And Indian music, specifically learning raga, taps you into...
What is raga?
Okay, raga, yeah, that's a very important... That's like, I was studying raga for, I think it took me about 3 years to know what raga was, even though I was practicing the scales. They're not exactly scales, but they're melodic movements. So, you know, scale in music terms?
La 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 la.
Yeah, do re mi fa sol la ti do. I don't actually do it in Western anymore. But in Indian music or Afghan music, Pakistani music, you have this, it's called raga, and it's still like the notes, we still use the same, you know, general 12 notes, but then there's all these little movements in between. And so when you sing, you might skip some notes on the way up and add some in the way down, or it's the way you move between the notes. So it's not a linear scale that people are singing in. It's a sort of set of movements. And the way those movements have come about is just, you know, hundreds of years of people singing in that sort of melodic framework. But there, it's like you're always referencing other songs by masters who have created this music that people have sung. So the rag becomes more like a, not so much like a scale set of notes, like a set of parameters, but it's more like a personality. So you get to know the feel, like almost like the contour of somebody's face is the contour of the way this rag unfolds. And they talk about it like unfolding, because you can kind of talk about each note, and as you unfold each note, you sing how you get to it from below, how you get to it from above. And it's very specific how that happens. So you can't just say, I'm going to sing in this rag and I read it on a page and I'm going to sing that.
Is it
you
different every time?
Hmm?
Is it different every time when people sing a specific piece? Oh, so it's like it's deliberately tapping into the intuitive, like, you know,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but you have to practice, like, you do have to get it in your brain first, how you approach each note in the rag. So each note in the scale, but it's a rag, so it's bigger than a scale. It's more has more cultural context, I guess.
I had a similar discussion with do you know Brian Riley?
No.
He's one of Zeus's friends. He's into circus and puppetry.
Oh, cool.
And I said, so are you a puppeteer? He's like, I don't know how to answer that. You know, he knows. It took a whole discussion to get to the point where he learned little bits. He's like, yeah, you can practice and practice and practice and balance on this thing where, like, it's a ball with a plank and you kind of stand on it and then you throw this thing up and you catch it in a special way, and it takes hundreds of hours of practice, and now you have this like 5-second thing you can do.
Yeah, it's like that. Yeah, it's precisely like that. And that's why if you say, are you a master? No.
Yeah.
I'm certainly not a master of Indian music. But my teacher is a master, and learning from her is pretty amazing. Like, to be in that presence is like, she's able to share that. And my teachers before, I was just so blessed. Somehow it feels like I was really meant to be there because of the people who took me in, like my sarangi teachers. A sarangi is an instrument that I play, Indian instrument, and it's I had two.
What is a sarangi?
It's got 40 strings, but most of them are resonating strings.
Okay.
So you play on three, and is the it, others all fill out the sound.
Oh, neat. Oh.
Like a sitar has that, like all these background strings. I didn't realize that. You don't actually touch them, but they resonate with the note you play.
Oh, that is so Jedi, man. That's
beautiful. Yeah. Yeah, you can Google it if you want. Sarangi. S-A-R-A-N-G-I.
I disconnected the internet on the system today because we're not going to pull up any pictures. But that's...
It's a pretty magical sound. And so I had sarangi teachers and I have a teacher, musical mentor in Holland, Upor.
And then that's a jump. Holland? Like Dutch? Is it?
He is Dutch and he is... really been a guide for me over the last
Is he
Indian music?
Okay,
yeah, because that was the music. I mean, he grew up playing violin.
Is he Indian or is
no,
he
he's Dutch?
So he's like there's a few people like you who are sort of like, you know,
he helped like little, me a
little
lot.
Old souls spread across the globe. They're trying to find their way back to the source. You know, it's
exactly, and he's he has devoted his life to music and to teaching, starting schools in Europe that teach world music, but I mean primarily for him Indian music, but he actually started getting different styles of music into the conservatories in Europe, which has just been, you know, it's so important that we don't say music and mean only one style.
Like, yeah,
you know, if you go to music school in Canada, you're learning Western classical music,
sure,
but you're not, and people are under the assumption that they're learning music, but what they're learning is Western classical music, you know, and that it's a very small style compared to all the styles of music in the world. And if you want to have really a broad understanding of music, you don't, it's not like you have to learn how to play every style, but at least understand that there it's
so
all relevant.
I'm glad we had you in today, because literally I feel like, okay, I'm breaking my brain apart from its crystallized structure to learn a few new things. Because like my grandfather, my father, both were engineers.
Yeah.
And so we, you know, music, that's fascinating. How do we, what are the rules? And so it's like, la, 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 la. That's, exactly. Those are the notes. This is how it works. Here's a resonant for it. And it's just like, and now we can build it into a little electric piano or just hit, and it's like, but that, you know, we're done. That's it. We got it.
We learned music. Music, you know? And we, you know, and like that's, well, that's it, right? And I feel like that's, I mean, it's a very limited perspective, and yet if we only ever talk about it like that's what it is and everything else is outside of music or a different, like other music, because we have, even in the academic world, we have musicology, which is the study of Western classical music, and we have ethnomusicology, which is the study of all the other things, you know, as if it's sort of a separate idea. Like, I remember meeting a girl in a swimming pool in Mumbai. Okay. Sometimes you just need to go to a swimming pool. And she was Canadian. And so I think I heard her talking across the pool. I was like, I know that accent. And so we sort of swam to each other and had a conversation in the pool. And she asked what I did. And I said I was a musician. And
I would like to draw that, actually. What a great, you know, I'm hot today. I have to meet this special person, but I don't know how. And then you're in the pool. It's like, it's a hot day, eh? You know, I'm just guessing.
That's actually a prairie accent, actually. She's from the prairies, I think. And she had learned flute, I think, at school or something. Anyway, we had this conversation because she asked what I do, and I said I was a musician, and we talked about it for a while, and then I don't know how it came up. She said something about how she wanted to play music too, but she just kept getting, you know, she couldn't read that well or whatever. And I was like, well, I've been a professional musician most of my adult life, well, pretty much all of it, and I don't really read music, like almost never. And she was just floored by the idea that you could play music and not have to read it.
Interesting.
Because that sort of, you know, that's a big draw for people. Like, they learn in school that music is written like this, and that you read this and you play this, and you're judged and you're graded on how well you read something in school band. And so that's sort of how people gauge what kind of musician they are. Well, I wasn't very good at it, you know, but because they're not really, well, maybe I think it's changing a bit now, but trained to really like hear something and repeat it on your instrument or in your voice. Like, that's music. Writing is that has nothing to do with music.
It's like a sort of paper version of that little plinky piano. You know Liam Potter, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so he's one of my favorite people. He's one of these gifted musicians, and he could never read music, but he never Did you ever talk to him about this? Because he always felt ashamed of it. He was like, because at one point said, okay, dude, you know, you're moving out on your own. Great job is coming up. You're going to be a studio musician. You sound great for CBC needs a guy to do the thing, you know? And he's going, great, I'll do it. And everything sounded positive. So, okay, well, you come on in and here's the, he goes, oh, I can't read music.
Here's the charts,
yeah. And he's like, oh, I don't know how to, and that was it. The gates came down, he's out. But that's like sort of the industrial music thing. And he was, and he didn't really, he's in construction now. Which is not a bad thing. Like, I think it's really good to use your body, be strong. He's in a pretty happy place. But you all, when you met little 12-year-old Liam, you're just like, I want him to fly with his guitar, you know? And he's not doing that now.
Well, and it'll come back. I mean, it's part of his soul.
Yes.
You can't take music out of a person. And also, music doesn't have to be your job if it is part of your soul.
I think it's actually important to, like, I've done art as the job, and get to the point where you're like, I hate going to work. And how can I say that about something that feeds my soul?
I know. And I thought my best, like, my biggest dream was to be hired as a musician somewhere. And when I was finally hired as a musician in China, was to play 2 shows a day. Some days I had it easy and I only had to play 1 show, but it was brutal. I did it for 5 months, I think. And I just was like, I made more money than I had ever made.
Michael Bay was on a Disney cruise ship as a musician. Did you know that?
I did.
And that's like, tell me about that story. He's just like, I'd rather not think about it. I'm home now.
It's hard when it's like you're a technician. You're sort of doing your thing. You're going through the motions. I mean, you know.
What were you doing in China? I'd like want to hear that story.
Playing music?
Were you like in a hotel or?
Yeah, that was a very fine restaurant. And it was really funny because I have all these different musical identities. Mm. You know, there's the folk, sort of down to earth folk singer, and then the, you know, Indian music student, you know, which is a very sort of traditional role in a way. And then in China, it was all like heels, like, the hair had to be done, the makeup had to be done, a gown every day.
Well, you pretend to be sort of the Humphrey Bogart kind of era.
It was jazz. The foreign jazz singer was basically what they hired, what they wanted, which is great. I mean, I love that. I love to be able to play music like that every day. But I found it very, in the end, very soul-sucking because the people who were in the restaurant, they didn't care about, they couldn't, because also it was a different culture. So. Yeah. I mean, you try to get hired anywhere as a jazz musician anymore. Like, it's in North America, we've kind of moved away from that being the sound everybody wants. But in China, they want that sound. But the audience, they don't relate to it. They don't sing, they don't know the words. It's not their style of music. It's a foreign sound. It'd be like if you're hearing Chinese music, like you might think it was cool, but you're not like feeling the passion, the cultural references that are all going on.
Let me tell you this interesting anecdote, and I didn't see this myself. My friend told me, and it's one of these friendships where when he describes things to me, I can see what he's seeing. We're that well connected, right, over many years. And he's got a connection to China and Hong Kong, and sort of has friends, close friends there. And he was saying there was this one concert, and it was in one of these cities. There was a ton of migrant factory labor. So they're making iPhones during the day, and they come out to this thing. And I have to clear my emotions so I can tell this. It was someone performing Country Roads. Country Roads.
It is a classic. They love it in China. They love it. I had to sing that song so many times.
And they were singing along, and they're all in tears. And they're just like, because I guess they come from these little teeny villages to the big city. And they're remembering where they came from. And like, you know, you're in like the iPad factory, right? And but where did that song come from? From like little town in...
Well, my experience with that was really interesting because people don't know English, but they know all the words to that song.
Yeah.
So it's somehow, it has, I think, even a different cultural reference in China. I don't know, actually, I should look up why. There's like 2 or 3 songs that everybody knew in English. Mm. Yeah, Country Roads, it has a deep resonance for people, and they love to sing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's so cool.
There was even a Japanese, totally different culture, made an animated film kind of built around that, like in Studio Ghibli, like the Miyazaki. Have you ever seen any of his stuff?
No.
You probably have. There was one called Spirited Away that was really big.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so there was a sort of one little film called Whispers of the Heart. And it was about two, you know, junior high kids who fall in love. And it was a lovely little story where this girl keeps going to she loves reading books at the library. And she knows the little library cards. She's like, someone who always gets these books ahead of me and reads them first, and it's this guy's name. Who that? And she's got this little mystery to solve. And, you know, she's like, okay, my dad knows a person who works at the library and a book that just came in. The library just bought it. I'm the first to get it. And she gets it. This guy, how did he get it first? Turns out it's the son of the, anyway, he's a violin maker. And he's learning how to make violins. And it's just this, it's this beautiful little young love story. But throughout it, she and her friends are trying to transcribe a Japanese version of Country Roads. And it gets played several, it's so beautiful. Anyway, but why that one? Why, you know, make a movie around it? That's astonishing, you know?
Yeah.
What a lightning strike or a piece of energy that just crosses the world in a...
I mean, it is a good song.
It's a great song.
It's a great song. And yeah. So it is kind of groovy that it caught
there.
I don't know why. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. I did get to sing that song a lot.
Really? Did you? Oh, I guess so, yeah.
That one. Oh, there was another one. I don't know if I remember what it's called. Was it The Carpenters?
Was it?
It's a song that goes, every sha-la-la-la. Wow, wow, still shines. I don't remember. It's just, anyway, it's another one that they loved. And then the Titanic theme. So those are the three that I had to sing quite a bit to if I wanted people to
pay you.
Be happy.
Yeah. Really. It's all about dying in the North Atlantic, you know? It's like,
yeah.
Oh, geez. Wow. So what took you to China? Like, how did you wind up there?
Camille and my sister had moved there. You know, in the life of a musician, every so often everything falls apart, and whether it's your body, so you can't sing, or in her case, she had a nerve damage, nerve problem, and she couldn't actually use her arm, so she was trying to do some like musical engineering.
Mike was saying that he injured his hands on that friggin' Disney cruise, you know? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, for her, it was a different kind of injury, actually. I think it was from learning the theremin. Anyway... that's a whole other...
A theremin?
That's a whole other story. Okay, we don't even have time.
Okay.
but anyway, so she ended up with a bad injury and she needed to work at something. And so our brother Alexander was in China. So she went to be with him and just sort of work on things and quickly found herself in a bossa nova band. So this is like Brazilian music in China.
Brazilian band.
Yeah, because she had been in Brazil earlier. Oh, and so she... You know, she could sing Brazilian songs and she had, you know, was really interested in Brazilian music and then found a band there and then she became their lead singer and then she started a bossa nova band. And so all these things happened. So Camila, my sister, became, you know, from Wolfville, Nova Scotia, became this sort of Brazilian star of Beijing. And the Brazilian embassy would always hire her to do all their, you know, music shows. Like they constantly had her and they were all shocked that she wasn't Brazilian. And if you look at Camila, like you could totally think, yeah, she's from Brazil. Just the way she, you know, skin tone, her long, curly, dark hair. And like,
I don't know Camila at all.
Oh, you don't?
I got to meet her at some point.
Oh yeah. It's just, yeah. Well, look her up online too. Camila. I think it's actually Camila.
I mean, I know Ariana really well.
Yeah.
She's nuts. I love that
Ariana,
woman.
Ariana. Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. I have some Ariana stories, but yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I know they're amazing. And so she moved there. Then she was, you know, after a few years, she was pretty kind of lonely. I was like, come. So I had just finished that degree that I really went to university kind of to get away from my music career at the time, which was, I mean, I just say, I feel like we change all the time with it, right? But at that time, we were playing all the time before I went to York. And I felt like my whole life was playing songs. And then as soon as the tour would end, I'd have to get a job of some sort. So I'd like serve tables and then I would start writing songs about serving tables. And then I was like, I just didn't have much to write about because for like the 7 years of my early adulthood, it had been just playing.
You and, have like, to go experience constantly. Before, yeah.
Yeah. Know, and so I was like, songwriting is my passion. Like that's what I want to do. And I need more life. Like I need to do something else.
Yeah.
And I think school was kind of like a thing to do. For me, I just wanted to learn. I wanted to know what I didn't know. And I did it, and it was turned out to be amazing, amazing degree. Took me to India. As soon as it was over, Camila was like, there was a really good sale on tickets to Beijing, so I bought you a one-way ticket.
I was like, thanks.
I was like, what? It's like, I couldn't pass it up. I didn't have time. It was nighttime for you. And if I didn't buy it just then, it would have expired.
You're going to Beijing. You know, off you go.
So I was like, I'm exhausted. I just got through this crazy last year. And a couple of my friends passed away at the time.
Oh,
it was just like,
God.
It was emotional. And then I was like, well, okay. So I packed my bags. One-way ticket to Beijing. You could still do that then.
How many days between finishing school and airplane to Beijing?
I really don't think it was long. I don't remember if it was weeks or...
How old were you at that time?
Well, now I was... Let me see. If I started at 25, 26, I think I was 30, 31.
Okay, so you have a little bit of life grounding to sort of make that...
I
had a lot.
I mean, even before I went to do my undergrad, I was already... pretty.
Can you imagine doing that at 19 or something like that? Because
just
making that kind of dramatic life shift, like, oh, you're now flying to another country.
I can. Oh. That was another story. But yeah, no. See, it was cool. I just went and just observed her for a while, and then started like playing jazz with the bands and did the thing. Like, she kind of got me into the scene and became kind of my manager, because she could speak Chinese by then. Oh, she'd been there a few years. My brother is completely fluent. He's still there. And like, yeah.
Have the three of you, like Camilla, Ariana, and you, have you ever toured together? Have you ever done any
sort
of...
We did a big one. Actually, this community around here helped us do... we formed a group called Ask Your Sister.
Oh, yes. Yes, I remember. Yes.
Which turned out to be a great name in Chinese. Because ask your, like, an insult in China is ask your mother.
Oh,
like,
really?
Ask your mother. You know, it's like this dirty thing to say, actually. In Chinese, it sort of translates. And Ask Your Sister was such a cheeky play on that that we didn't know. Mm-hmm. Because for us, it was kind of ask as our Ariana, Sahara, Camilla, like our names, and I don't know, it's just this thing that developed. But in China, it became like this amazing band name. So what we did is we the three of us and Andy, Ariana's husband, went to India to sort of develop a show, and we toured around and did all the like the clubs in Goa or whatever. And then once we had the show developed, then we went to China and we toured it all around China. And China was amazing because they have what they call live houses. And to me, live houses feel like what it must have been like when rock and roll first like exploded in North America, and they had these like dedicated dance halls, like great systems, great sound systems, sound people, like really high tech everything. Well, now in China it's like that anyway. And just but what I mean about the comparison is the energy. Like, people would come out of their jobs and just want to hear music and want to hear live music and want to hear original music, and just such a scene. And we toured all around the south, and then we went back up to Beijing, and yeah, it was cool. It was a great tour. So that was the one time that the three of us have really toured together, because we are always doing different projects.
Of course.
And now we have a new band called Ashk.
Ashk.
And Ashk means tear in Dari, which is our dad's language, and it means love in Turkish.
Oh.
And it is actually Camila's middle name as well. But it's a, so that in that band, we do more like Persian music, Indian, and sort of Eastern European, some Roma. So that's because the three of us have very specific sort of expertise, I guess, in those areas. So we, each one of us will sort of front a song that we can carry and the others back us up.
Yeah.
So that's been a really fun project too. So that one we haven't toured with as much, but I think once the world kind of chills out a bit, maybe we'll get back on that.
Jeez.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for, you know, the world to crack open and for all these like sort of subverse kind of expert, how do I describe this, you're too good to not be known world over. Why is that the case? Why are you not, this should be headline news everywhere, like the three sisters are traveling there, you got this cool thing, because you're like, the skill's obviously there, the intent is so amazing, and you just, the kind of energy, you're plugged in, and yet I have to know you through someone who knows you to sort of be, you know, oh, they're performing here in Little Wolf Phil, Ask Your Sister. Oh, I heard about that because I know a friend who knows. How have you not sort of made it into the giant mainstream?
I have been thinking about that over the last couple of years a fair bit, because, I mean, for us, we are, I feel...
Is the giant mainstream just too simple?
Well, I feel like, and you would probably relate to this too, because there's a sort of artist nature, right? There's like, the thing that I feel motivated by is not superstardom or money.
Of course.
You know, the thing that I'm motivated by is like, I need to know a thing about a thing. Like, I have to go in, and that takes time, and that takes I mean, I will be where I want to be musically in another 10 to 20 years. That's my like linear path. And that's what motivates me personally. For Ariana, she is, I mean, I consider Ariana a master. And
so
at, you know, yeah. In saxophone, in music in general, yeah. Like her skill level is really high, and her motivation is to play, right? But it's not to play under someone else's direction or someone else's sort of set of parameters, or having an industry say you should look like this, you should show up here, you should be this, you should do this. Like she is extremely powerful. Like when she plays, people come. So even if she's playing on the street in Montreal, which she loves to do,
Let me tell you a quick little story.
Side story.
Yeah. Sorry. So a friend of mine. Do you know Gib McGinnis?
No. Gilbert?
Okay, he's a university guy. I got to get him on the show at some point. And he was in Montreal, or was it somewhere with stone streets? Might have been Quebec. I don't know. Mm-hmm. And he was just biking around because that's what he does. And he heard just a little bit of saxophone. He goes, "That's Ariana." And he's in the.
You know her, you can tell.
He didn't even know that she was in the city. He just sort of honed in on the music, and there she was with the huge crowd.
Yeah.
But he knew it was her just from the way
she plays in the old Montreal.
Wow.
And if anyone is there, you should go because she's often there. And you know, and people have that question, like, why aren't you on the stage? I mean, Ariana can sell out any theater in Nova Scotia easily. Yeah. But that's not like. That doesn't give her the artistic freedom that she wants on a daily basis, right? She can play when she wants. She always can gather a crowd. She creates these magical live moments in the world.
Yeah.
Like, that's her motivation. So I think being like famous, if that's your motivation, it will take you to that kind of space. But it's competitive, which is not our characteristic really. It's like, it's sort of
competitive. I was at it was an open mic in Toronto. I took a friend of mine we made a CD together. I produced it, and he was this amazing singer. So let's go try some of this out. And we're there, and he was like, "Oh, I love open mics." He was telling me all about Nova Scotian open mics, about this, the camaraderie, and everyone's just so happy to be a musician. And he was there, and you know, there's another guy with a very expensive guitar. "Oh, is that a such and such guitar?" He goes, "Yeah." He goes, "Wow, it's a good guitar. Well, you gotta, you know," and he was just like, the attitude was like, "Yeah, it is the best guitar. What are you playing?" And it was just like, whoa.
It's like, we're not in Nova Scotia anymore.
Success in this particular venue was all about kick your neighbor, because how are you going to get to the it's like, what a different way of doing things. And he was just like, whatever, you know?
Yeah. Well, I used to love that about the folk scene right across the country when I was between my ages of like, whatever, 18 and probably around 25 when I decided to take a break from it. We were in this very supportive musical community, and it was not about being the best act of the night, or it wasn't about being better than someone else, or it was about having this musical community where the audience was also involved and we were involved, and the people would host us, and the love that sort of that we were in. I say we, because Camille and I used to tour around at that time. We did a few albums together, and we were just like in this love bubble all the time of musical, you know, and the festivals were run pretty grassroots. Like, people were interested in somebody. It didn't have to be because they were famous. Maybe they were a farmer, but they also had this great act. And so then they would be, you know, or a plumber, but they had this great act, and then they would be on the thing and on the stage, and we'd all love what they did. But it wasn't this big sort of ego trip of being a famous musician. And I feel like in my lifetime, watching festivals, even in the country, have all sort of, you know, the board, now the festival board of the festival, makes a certain decision, and then they want big names, and then they want this whole thing, which is kind of, you know, how big is your YouTube following, and how big is your...
There's the engineering corporate side versus the intuitive side, and they both need to exist on a certain level. But as you're talking about this, I relate everything to sort of kung fu practices, and I'm not a kung fu guy, but I spent so much time focusing on written characters about it, cool, who deal with it, and it's just like... it's like there's secret knowledge connected to this. And if you go into the geek world, you're looking at the Jedi, you know, and it's like some knowledge you can just put out there and it resonates with everyone. But then in order to properly engage with it, you can't have it given to you. You've got to go and find it. And what you're just,
yes. You know, and then that kind of gives life meaning also. Like, I mean, yes, we all could have, I feel like any of us could have worked as,
you know, in the industry in that way, like gone for it or kind of committed to a life. I don't know. We're not a very mainstream group of musicians, me and those two, because we love to explore the world. Yeah. And I feel like when you're playing like with managers and you're playing with, you know, as an industry person, mm-hmm. and that's what like the industry sort of takes you over, and then there's all these a new set of parameters you have to live within. But we are a very explorative bunch, so I don't know. We're pretty happy, and we do get that kind of question, like, why aren't you more famous, or why aren't?
I pretty much knew the answer when I asked it, but it hadn't sort of, you know.
It's not. I'm not even giving a direct answer. Like, I'm not saying that. It's not like I wanted it one way or the other. It's just like whatever happens. And there were times in that sort of in the last 20 years of playing music around where I felt very much like, wow, like I can see the whole world from up on this mountain, you know? Yeah, yeah. And there's other times when it's just like, I'm alone in this hole. Nobody cares. So, and I don't know, I'm okay with that. I feel like both experiences and everything in between is really important. So it all feeds sort of the artistic.
Well, there's something about this very fundamental, primal sort of seeking of approval. Like, how many thumbs up did you get? How many likes on your your thing? And you're sort of like, well, it is important, but to pin your entire identity and sense of self-worth to this not arbitrary. It's just like very fickle and very it's shallow, man. It's like I've seen mm-hmm. you know, videos of like, you know, the happy cat falling in the pool, and it's like that's a million views. Yeah. I'm one of the viewers.
You're like
you know. But that's not how much energy was put in. Like, where it first hit me was I was quite young. I was, I guess, in my early 20s, and I was killing myself to make this beautiful vision in comics. Mm. And there's this one comic that came out that was like, you just look at, well, their numbers, how many sales are they getting versus where I am, and how much work are they putting in, and what are they doing artistically? And you immediately look for the greatest ratio difference. There's one, it was genius, actually. I look back on it now, I think it's hilarious. It was a bunch of Dungeons and Dragons players done as little cartoon characters, badly drawn. It was by an artist who can't draw very well.
Yeah.
Just sort of copped them all, sitting around a table, and that's the only drawing that ever appeared. He just photocopied it over and over and over again, you know, issue after issue, and just changed the speech bubbles. And it was just the silly conversations, which apparently were very well observed. Like, he knew how to write, and he knew how to sort of, and it was incredibly popular. Like, I must have made $1 million selling this thing. And I'm just like, that page took literally, it was 3 photocopies, and you look at how much work you put into one page that, you know, a couple thousand people might look at versus 40 or 50 or 60,000. You're like, oh, what am I doing? And then you have to remind yourself why you're there. But it's a funny little pull back and forth. Like, why am I even being pulled? I shouldn't be. This is not important, but it is, you know, because you're not singing alone.
No,
you know,
no. And actually the whole state of the world right now brings that very much to heart. Like, we played a couple of live shows in the last month after all of this time. Like, we had all these tours booked, and of course they all got canceled. Right. But the last shows we played were in Canada last fall before we left. Then we came back expecting to start the tour, and then of course everything got canceled, so not until August. So it's almost a year of like not playing live.
Wow.
A lot of study, a lot of practice, a lot of creative stuff, writing and filming and things, but not playing live. And then that feeling of playing live, because you feel very isolated. I think all musicians right now in whatever context are feeling pretty like, wow, we might be losing our whole world as far as playing for an audience. I mean, playing for a, you know, a YouTube audience is a very different thing. Playing for a camera is a very different thing. But playing for a live audience where you're just sparkling.
It's real biofeedback. Like, here, the energy is instantly scrambled because it's digitized. It's turned into little dots and ones and zeros, and you get the engineering essence of it. I've heard some great recordings that send chills, right? But like watching you perform live, it's like, whoa, you're a very powerful woman, and it just travels through you in the most wonderful way. It's magnificent. It's magnificent. Yeah. So yeah, I've only watched like, I think, one live performance that you did. It was in like the curling rink, you know. It was
that's a long time ago.
Long time ago, but it was stunning. You know, and I got to get out more, man. Like, so do you have any more live times come or live performances booked or that you can sneak by? Or?
There probably will be a few things, but there's nothing really on the horizon because there's just not a much. There's not. People are afraid to commit to any kind of group getting together at this point, which makes sense.
Yeah,
you can't
yeah.
to promote a show and do all that work and then not have it be able to happen or whatever.
I think it's really interesting, like this muzzle law. You know, like the top down control, because it's. I have a very conspiratorial view of the yep. whole thing, as I'm, you know, and it's not 100%, you know, there's some real concern there. Mm-hmm. I get it. Mm-hmm. But I can see like the evil manipulators going, yeah, we have to cut out the spirit. This is what a great way of doing it. All the live performances are gone. We've just won 20% of the human race just by cutting that, you know, cut back their power, take their soul away from them.
I have a very
you know?
Strong feeling that that is not an intentional occurrence.
You live a happier life than me.
I do, though. I feel like it is an accident of the egoic mind taking over the world, right? And it is something that's going to continuously happen in all the places where, and we see it. We see it any time that the thirst for power or identity or, you know, it's basically power and identity, where that takes over all the decision making. And then what is left, like what we are left with is a kind of sad existence, you know? And then the spirit is like, hello, hello.
And you can't stop it. You can't stop it.
And nobody wants to stop it. They just don't realize that it's important because it doesn't sort of factor into the mental calculations that we're always making.
Are you
going to
have like sort of speakeasy kind of, okay, everyone, we're going to have a performance in this little secret club. And
yes, and I'll let you know about it.
Oh my God.
And I will. Actually, and you know, this is something I wanted to say, because when we're talking about audiences and stuff, I mean, I've played on stages for thousands of people, mm-hmm. and that is an amazing feeling, mm-hmm. and it's really fun. But I've played on stages for 30 people, and it's my favorite.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, again, we talk about motivations. Like, in that room of 30 people, 30 to 60 people, you feel every person, and every person feels you, like, huh. as yeah, a performer, yeah. as a, you know, there's a connection that actually, like, it goes to that soul place. I mean, even I've been to concerts where I'm one, you know, the nosebleed section of something.
I don't think you were artificially amplified at that thing that I saw. So it was all direct. There was no machinery or electronics stepping in between. But yeah.
Possible.
Possibly. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, I love that. I love that personal connection. And it's enough. The idea that a musician needs a million people to see them to be validated is crazy. That doesn't make sense. That is not a human, that's a totally artificial experience, and nobody can feel anything like from that. Not what I'm talking about, not what you're talking about.
Yeah.
That feeling we're talking about, that is what I live for. So this whole like, yeah, if you're not good enough because you don't have, you know, whatever, a million copies sold or a million views, right, or whatever, right. like that's totally not that sort of soul expression thing that will always be there no matter what the industry does and no matter what, you know, cut downs. And, you know, if we get I could reference the Cultural Revolution here in China, but like where things just become about industry or become yeah. about whatever, you know, control or whatever, you still can't. In some countries, like you see that when the artists get together under those kind of circumstances, there's more power. There's more sense of actually being useful, having a place in the world. Because we've all of us, I'm sure all of us have felt over the last 20 years, and we know, you and I can tell, like 20 years before that, there was a different spark in terms of what the effect the artists had. And now, because there's so much more online, and there's so much more competition, and there's so much more access, it's like the audience is also tired.
Yes.
We're all tired as like...
We're overstimulated.
Overstimulated. Yeah. So where's the place for all of that magic? You know, like it has to be in smaller groups.
We're going to dip there for a little while. You'll see in a second. Then we're going to come right back out because this is not what this podcast is about. But Germany during the war.
Yeah.
It was... So you had like the Hitler, the Nazi youth. But then the generation that came up behind them, because these are all mind program kids or like Heil Hitler or, you know, Zeke Hailing or whatever, their younger brothers and sisters were just like, the fuck, you know, they were yeah. into that. They went the other way as kids do. And they were powerful. And I never read about them, but they were significant in actually crumbling that that empire from within. You know what they do as a rebellious thing? And they could be killed for this. They would sneak away together and have campfires and sing culturally, you know, powerful old songs. They'd sing folk songs.
Yeah.
And they knew they were being naughty, you know?
Yeah.
And that's like, and they were getting, like, their leaders were being hanged. You know, like the SS was hunting them down because how dare you? And it was literally, you know, you say, I don't think that there's a conscious effort to cut back on spirit. Maybe not, but that's how I calculate the world, is like, how much spirit is there and who's winning? The dark side, they may not understand why they want to shut it down, but it's life, you know? And if you're coming from a nihilist position, that's the enemy, right? Mm. So those kids sitting around campfires, it's very powerful.
Just letting their souls be free. Well, I mean, that was so much of my youth, was that kind of, whenever we had parties, there was music, there was singing, there was people, you know, in a circle doing things.
Well, Nova Scotian kitchen parties are like famous, right?
The best, right? Well, Newfoundland.
Newfoundland, okay.
Well, the whole East Coast. Coast.
The kitchen closer you get to the amazing. Water, the more hobbity everything, or more magical.
Yeah, it's incredible. And I remember my first party in Toronto where I brought a guitar because that's what you do for a party. And then everybody was like sitting around talking and I was like, oh my God. Like, where's the party in this party? Like, there was no that, and it was all musicians and artists and theater people at this party, and I was so surprised that they didn't know that style of
the kung fu guy that I was training
creation.
With met him in Toronto. He was a Nova Scotian dude. Mm. He would describe Toronto like, he's like, reality is thin here. Like, and we went for a walk one time and he was just like, this whole neighborhood, it's like, it's barely here. And I was like, what do you mean? It's like, and it was, that's a whole other discussion, but you know, I learned a lot.
Well, it's also like what we look for.
Yeah.
You know, what I looked for as far as connection and feeling good about myself and everybody in the room was totally not what they looked for to feel the same thing. Mm. So it is, again, a cultural difference.
There's a big cultural
difference. We judge
it
sometimes,
yeah,
but I feel like it's also just a different
like when I moved here from Toronto, everyone says, you're from Toronto. It's like, how can you tell? It's because you're going three times faster than everyone else. You talk fast. You're very precise. You're success oriented. It just, and they weren't criticized. They're just going, yeah, give it a few years. And I was like, okay. But it's true. Like, I was just like, gotta get this done. It was like living it was a pretty cool machine to be part of. I got a lot of great work done when I was in Toronto, but it was distant from, I don't know, the wellspring of where creativity comes from.
Yes, it doesn't fill the wells as easily. But yeah, no, I know. It is interesting. We can usually spot Ontario.
Yeah. No, I have a story about that, but I'm not going to get into it because I'm not feeling the vibe. How long have we been recording, Zeus?
1 hour and 10.
1 hour 10? Yeah.
Wow.
Well, do you feel like taking a quick break? Or?
Yes, yeah.
Right, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
Yeah, wow.
I guess.
Oh, my God. Wow, so how long do these interviews go? Because that's long.
Well, I like it to aim for about 2 hours.
Do you?
Yeah.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't get
totally
good.
Oh, I'm totally fine. I was just surprised. I'm thinking usually, because I guess I'm used to interviews being 5 to 10 minutes.
Yeah. So. No, man. Well, they don't get good until about, my goal is to get to the point where I have the energy to sort of carry on to the next part, because you'll talk through all the brochure stuff. I mean, not saying that's what you're doing, but it's just like you get through the basics and then you sort of get into the person and then, you know, that's
and then the juice comes.
It's just, well, like you're getting to places where you never normally explore, and it's just, it happens naturally, right?
Yeah. People have a way of talking about themselves that they're used to saying, right? So you want to get maybe past it.
Yeah.
A little bit.
I'm going to go get another coffee and clean the dishes. If you need to use the washroom,
Building.
I believe so.
Yeah, when I went to school, was it still a music building?
Is it still rolling? Cool. Easy peasy. Natalie gave us a whole bag of
sugar.
Sugar, yeah. Acadian maple peanut brittle.
Maple.
We're back, folks, and we have. Oh my god, a donut! I don't. I'm gonna have a little tiny bit just because.
Brittle.
That's my sugar for the month.
Maple. Mm. Yeah, that's pretty special.
Yeah, we'll chew into our mics. It'll sound wonderful.
Oh yeah. No.
Oh, that's nice, eh?
Mm. Amazing.
Definitely gonna be. Oh.
It's like getting starting to rain out there.
Oh.
Seems moist and humid out there.
It's looking like we're gonna get some rain. Feels that way. Anyway, we're back. We never really left. We just left the cameras rolling, so. Getting into, I don't know if we're going to call this part two. What do you feel like talking about? What's on your mind right now? What were you thinking about this morning? What did you wake up? What was your dream last night? What did you wake up from?
Oh, wow. I had some weird dreams.
It's been like that, yeah.
That kind of morning where I woke up and then went back to sleep and then had really intense dreams, which I can't talk about.
Oh, boy.
Publicly. But let's think. I was thinking about you.
Really?
Yep. And your, your creative motivations, because to me, your work is incredibly layered. Like, and it's interesting because it had such like a deep kind of cultural observation element, and a lot of, sort of social, political commentary, and fun, and like interesting wildness. I don't know, it's an incredibly layered experience to read it. So. Yeah, I'm just kind of, I don't know. I was just curious about where.
You can interview me now.
Am I going to interview you? No, I don't know. I was interested in where it's taking you now, because.
This is a time of change right now.
It is.
Like, hardcore.
It?
And all the people who sort of plugged into the mechanics of spiritualism, and that's me, are like, what is going on? Because we can all feel it. Everyone knows something's up. They don't know what it is exactly, but this level of change and this level of sort of hysteria and this level of wish fulfillment almost. I mean, I don't know if you've noticed this, but the people with you get what you ask for. It's always been that way, but now it's very immediate. Like if you are pure or clean in yourself and you've cleaned out all your knots, you're not spending all your time delusional or lying to yourself or suppressing things, if you are in alignment with reality, which is not everybody. A lot of people are sort of, they're choosing their own reality and twisting information to make it fit that. And for some reason they do it to stay angry. I don't know why that is. But if you can clear that out and actually resonate correctly, now you can move towards the things that you are interested in exploring with rapidity. I mean, like,
yeah,
like for instance so it's time for me to move, and so I'm in this great house, I love it, but no, it's not perfect, and there's all these elements I can't really talk about because it's not sort of public stuff. I mean, I'm very public about my own things, but this involves other people. But you know, like, man, I really wish I could be in this kind of situation. And we're talking like, so the apartment next door to this place, you know, They had a spot open. There's nothing open. You can't rent anything up and down the valley. Everything is, it's dry. I mean, yeah. I went to one place. They have like, you know, Wolf Hill Court. No, the Skyway, way up at the top of that hill, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know what they call themselves. Wolf Hill Courts now. They have like over 100 units there. It's just this huge, it looks like a military encampment. It's like the barracks. They got to have something. I go into the office. We have nothing. You know, the units that are coming open in November are all spoken for and have waiting lists.
Amazing.
Go away. You know, like, they're polite. Oh, that sucks. Where am I going to live? You know, because the guy whose house I live in is selling it. He's like, yep, you better have some other situation because this house is not going to be around anymore. He's going to make a lot. I think he's talking about putting in skylights and that sort of thing to raise the value. Don't do that. Whoever buys it's going to wipe it out and build
$2 million.
Decisions. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you know, property in the Gaspar Valley is so beautiful, and that makes it valuable. Everyone's getting the hell out of the cities because the times are insane right now. Even in Canada, little Halifax, people are like, yeah, let's get into the valley there where it's a little
because all
crazy.
The fun is done. There's nothing fun to do. You can't go to a restaurant. You can't, you know, you can't go to a show. You can't
the
do
the fun is done. Let's go out here where it's at least you have a because you know I was quarantining for 2 weeks. Gary came back from Europe, so I couldn't leave either. So took some sick days and just sort of like, you know, but I had this beautiful property to sort of pluck around in.
Exactly. Oh, I built the most beautiful garden.
I got to see your garden. You this do. Is the sort of thing that's like, you look, where's, you know, you're looking for real gnomes, not the ceramic kind. You know,
yeah,
like,
there's no ceramic gnomes, but there are real gnomes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, cool, cool.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is that, so I was like, okay, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Just on the off chance, go to the property management that manages that building, and they manage a ton of stuff up and down the valley. Everything's full. Everything's full. And well, what about that place? Oh, you got to be. It's for mature living. It's 50 and up. I just turned 50, and they're like, "Oh, cool. Well, we'll fill out a thing because there's actually a spot." And I was like, "It's the only spot in the valley," and it puts me right next to the studio, right next to the people I love.
Kidding me?
Yeah. No, amazing. I mean, I'm not kidding you, right? But this was like, it couldn't have been more. If I wrote it in a story this way, I'd feel compelled to break it a bit because it's just too convenient. It would just seem forced.
Yeah.
But everything's like, this is just, yeah, whatever. And I don't feel fear anymore. Like normally, like, oh, you have to move. I'm like, I don't feel like getting angry or scared.
No.
I know it's going to fall into place. Just vibrate in the, and it seems very hippy dippy, but it's so true that you just, you can choose fear and anger, or you can choose the way of the force, you know. And man, Star Wars prepared all the geeks out there. They know.
Yeah.
And if you understand, you know, I will follow. I will do what I must, Obi-Wan. You know, it's just the force tells you what to do, and if you believe that and trust it, well, my God, it's a powerful. You can feel it, you know, and it just takes you to where you're supposed to be.
Yeah.
And this is part of a larger. I can get into this, but there's a reason. Like this doesn't happen. You know, thousands of years can pass before you get a time like this, and it's just going to get more and more and more so. And that the dark stuff, the angry stuff, the scary things, those are getting deeper. And it's just the highs and the lows are very high and very low, and you've got to learn how to surf that shit. Otherwise, you're going to get crushed. And so, anyway, that's
well, it's sort of like it speaks to different aspects of ourselves. So, and that's kind of what I was thinking about. It's that mental. Like all the fear and all the anger and all of the trying to survive or trying to get ahead so that you don't get, you know, taken over by others.
Yeah.
That's a very mental game. And if everybody plays that, like, it's not, you're, it takes us completely away from what you're talking about, which is just like trusting the moment, trusting that what's for you is there, like that it's there, that it's going to happen.
But I mean, people like you have been in practice for this for your whole life, so you're already fine.
Does feel like that, yeah.
But it's there's a lot of people who haven't. They don't know, and they're scared, and they don't know what's coming. Can you imagine living as a regular person and not understanding why is the universe doing this? It's just everything's shaking apart. This is not normal. And have someone like you go, you know, there's this. Just listening to you speak about music would give them a metaphor, give anyone a metaphor to say, oh, I understand. Maybe my life can work that way too. Because while you're talking about music, I'm thinking all of this applies to Kung Fu. Kung Fu applies to life. Just like, how do you buy a car?
It is.
How do you make those payments? They're just little motions, and you have to feel the right spot to move. And it's So I think people like you are really important, and I'm a little selfish, but I'm glad you're in Nova Scotia right now and not off in Beijing. They can find their own Jedi, you know?
There's lots of Jedis there, yeah. I agree. I think on a lot of levels, this what's really bothering people right now is not really bothering me on that same level. And part of it is because of a lot of travel. Mm. Like, not just travel, but I've never had a plan, really. I mean, I've had a plan. I've always known my path. Like, I've always known the overarching story, right? I just know it. I haven't had to wonder what it is, or I've often wondered, like, how is it going to happen? Because I don't always see it in front of me. But that sort of idea of, you know, job security or having a home, like having a home external to just existence, like that has never been a driving factor either. So this sort of constant change is my life, and I'm very much I think it's everybody's life, but we don't know that that's okay. Like, we have not accepted that that's life. That's just like cycles, and that's
seasons and that happens. So for me, it's like I go to one country and then I go to another country where the culture is completely opposite. I mean, I think of China and India because for some years I was going between China and India, where it's almost like two sides. There's very little overlap culturally. There's in India, for example, everybody speaks their mind and everybody has this like very deep sense of cultural.
This is in Beijing.
India is a bit known for chaos. Like there's just everything is happening all the time.
That's the sense.
People speak what they want. If you sit next to somebody on a bus and you're going to travel for like 3 or 4 days, which is normal in India, you will learn a lot. You know, it's not people don't censor themselves because they're very strong about who they are and what they, and they know that, you know, those people over there think differently than me. And that's totally fine. Like we're all in the same bus and we're all going to the same place and it's not a big deal.
Oh, that sounds great.
It is, it's cool. Yeah, I find it really cool. I mean, not everybody, obviously. There's always like sort of people who want to change other people, but for the most part, that's not even consideration because it's not possible in a place like India. But then you go to China and there's like this sort of sense of order. Things are incredibly advanced, incredibly like technologically, and like the streets are just smooth and clean, and there's public bathrooms everywhere. Not everybody has a bathroom in their house, but there is a place to go. Not the case in India, you know what I mean? So like
plumbing for what, 1.2 billion people is pretty remarkable.
Yeah, and when the government decides, okay, we're going to do a thing, everybody's going to get heating in their house, and it's going to be with this, you know, special heater where it heats up the rocks, you know, at night when electricity is cheaper, and in the day you just use the ambient heat or whatever. Like so these, like everybody on the whole street will get this thing. Like there's just this sense of things function collectively very easily. People are more or less on the same page. If they're not, there's problems for them. And yeah, so cultural things are not celebrated. They're kind of in China, you know, that's been pretty much in the news and everything. Like they're trying to suppress that kind of individualizing. It seems to be still happening. Whereas in India, it's just like it's celebrated. It's part of life. But, you know, so going between those two countries where in India, you might have to hold it for days on a bus because there's nowhere to go to the bathroom. Or you have to go do something very awkward somewhere because you have no choice. But like, this is kind of, this is just life. Like, I don't know.
Is there a metaphor between, or a parallel between the music that you're performing in each country? Like jazz in China.
Jazz in China is it's a very sort of, it was for very elite establishments, like very high-end restaurants or hotels, or it wasn't like the music people would want to necessarily go out and listen to. But there was a lot of that, like, because the other thing that I and my sister and our friends in Beijing love to do is go out and hear live music. We would also play our own music.
Okay.
That was on our own terms. Right. Like, we do our own show the way we do our own shows here, you know, for a club or for a bar or something. And the Ask Your Sister thing, that was all over it. So like they have everything. And I don't know how it is right now, and things keep changing. And in China, it changes fast and very collectively. Whereas in India, everything's happening kind of simultaneously within one group or another group, but it's not that it's.
China has a history. I've been reading about, everyone's interested in China, so I read books about it. And there are a couple of instances. One, there was this period in history where they had the world's most powerful, biggest, remarkable navy. Mm. And it was a very short time. They had ships that were like, that's not possible. Like the aircraft carrier size, you know, wooden boats. Maybe I'm exaggerating a bit, but it was like, you know, the emperor at the time said, we are going to have a navy. Everybody in the country is going to focus all their energy. Like, you know, if you're an artisan, you move to this province and you're now building ships. And so everyone, okay. And they all do.
Yeah.
And then you know, when you have like, I don't know how many, I don't think it was a billion people at that time, but it was the collective focused, willing resources of
an entire nation.
And then after, I think the leadership changed. It was like a little Game of Thrones bullshit going on there. And then the next guy said, no, fuck, you know, Navy. There's no one but us. In fact, if you're out seen in a boat, we're going to kill you. You know, you're not allowed to. There are heavy taxes for talking about the world being round and having other nations. So the whole thing was just shut down. So it was this little flash in the pan. And then there was a story I was telling Zeus. You got to check out this movie. One of my favorite science fiction writers is a Chinese guy. His name's Cixin Liu, if I'm pronouncing his name correctly. They call him the Chinese Asimov. Have you heard of him? He did his, you know, the famous books that you can read here are, it was this thing called The Three-Body Problem. Fascinating. And he, in that one, it was all about, oh, we've discovered that we're going to be invaded by a warring alien race. It's going to take them 300 years to get here. That's how long we have to prepare. So, and it's a multi-generational thing. Each book is a 100-year period, or I might be, it's been a while since I read it, but it's absolutely fascinating. So he thinks in these big terms. It's very, very, you know, it's like Stephen King's speed reading. They made a movie. It was called, I think it was called The Wandering Earth. Was that what it was called? Unwatchable. But high, but okay. So the idea was, oh no, something's wrong with the sun. It's going to get bigger. Anything too close to the sun is going to be roasted. We better move the earth. So what we're going to do is we come up with these giant fusion engines that's each the size of a mountain. If we have 10,000 of these engines built around the planet, we can just, you know, fly it out to another star. We're going to find another star. And, you know, half the planet is going to be, well, you know, each engine is its own city, and we can afford to house underground half the population. Well, what happens to the other half? Well, they die. They're for who, whatever. Anyway. But the thing is, what got me was it was the underlying assumptions. It was, okay, here's the plan. Let's do it. There's no sort of like, how did you get everyone on board with this? And there's like, I don't understand the question.
Yeah.
You know, did the French go along? Did the Americans say yes to this?
Why wouldn't they?
What? Can you? We built engines and we're flying it to, like, what? It, there's this, and you're, and that was fat. You're well, watching that film, just like, this is a Chinese movie.
Yeah.
This is using Chinese laws of reality to make this happen. It was, and I could only get halfway through because there's this other fascinating part. People having emotional meltdowns.
Yeah.
Like little screaming child fits, you know, and I'm like, yes. Does that happen in China? Mm-hmm. Does it? Oh, this is interesting.
Because people are very much not allowed to say what they mean and not allowed to feel what they feel for a lot of different reasons, political reasons, family reasons. It's just not culturally done. And so, you mean, bring on a little alcohol or a high stress situation and there's meltdowns because it's just like, when I would go back and forth, I would go from India, this sort of chaotic, you know, expressive kind of, you know, there's nowhere to go to the bathroom kind of place. Mm-hmm. And then I'd go to China and just be like, oh, thank goodness. Like everything is just functioning.
There's
like,
always so nice. A toilet, you know, yeah.
And then after a while, I'm like, I need to be able to express freely, or I need to hear other people express freely, or, you know, yeah, there was a big meltdown because something didn't go, you know, according. Not that there's not meltdowns, you know, in India or everywhere else, but it's a different feeling. And he probably tapped into that in the film because, yeah. Then I would like go back to India and be like, oh, thank goodness I can just be back on this bus and have a conversation about whatever you actually really feel.
Yeah.
You know, nobody's afraid that someone's going to take them out for it. I mean, unless it's a period, and that happens a lot in India because there's a lot of conflicting ideologies, right? So people tend to flare up in big riots and things, but then it's over. Like, it does happen, and sometimes a whole bunch of people get killed and there's violence, and it's quite scary and really sad, and usually for no particularly good reason, you know, in hindsight. But but then it's over, and then everybody's sort of okay, you know, after. At least it's been my observation, you know.
The people that I get along best with in work situations, if there's a conflict or there's something that's wrong, they'll say, Mark, we're going to talk, and it's a hard conversation, and it's like, you did this wrong, this wrong, this wrong, and it's just very, and I go, okay, and just like, it's like, this would be a fight norm, but you just get through it, and then you're done, and you're like, thanks for letting me, and it's just, everything's fine. Now, the other approach is like, you say nothing, and you
just brood. Because
you just brood, or you build consensus, and there's little whisper networks, and you just like, and everyone's just tiptoeing around and getting cancer, you know, it's just, learn how to so I like people who can just be really straight up. My best friends, if I screw up, they'll tell me straight up, and I want to fix it because I love my friends.
Yeah.
And now you're on the other side of it, and I feel like I can do the same thing. They expect the same from me. That's where respect comes from, and that's where
sort of an honesty, and also it creates like that kind of relationship creates this like,
I feel like honesty, you need a certain trust. You need to be, you need to trust that person enough to be honest with them about how you feel. Like there is, it's a two-way thing, you know?
Oh, for sure.
And so that's what I feel in some ways missing in that sort of cultural thing where people are not allowed to say what they feel because they can't even trust, you can't trust a person you just met to know what their politics are, if they're, you know, spying on you, if they're, because that's a valid concern that there's a lot of people who are there to sort of report to somebody if somebody says or does the wrong thing.
Like, when I was living in Toronto, a buddy of mine, this good friend of mine was working at a music school and they had a lot of Chinese, you know, people working there. And he would say, talking about, oh, wow, you're from, you know, what's going on, such and such. And they would like, no, there's no such thing as that problem. You know, they're behaving as though the secret police are in Canada, and maybe they are. You know, like, how big is the Chinese community? Like, and he just said it was very like, these are survival techniques that you groom throughout your adulthood. So if you emigrate, and now you're Canadian, you know, the CCP can't come and smack you, can they? Maybe it's I don't know, man. I think we're very, very fortunate to not have to deal with that. You know,
I think that's true, but I also think that we do deal with that on some levels. Yeah. That, you know, different groups within Canada also have that built in, and
trying real hard to build it that way. Anyway,
it's a human condition thing. You know, like it's not that it's not there in India, and it's certainly. It's here in Canada too. People have to be pretty careful, and actually, unfortunately, it's growing, right? That sense of having to be careful what you say or where you say it, and like not being able to trust that the people around you can just let you be yourself, or to that it's going to be okay to be yourself. Like, I mean, I think it's something for us all to sort of notice, at least notice, right? That there is these trends towards.
I don't have a Twitter account, and I feel like Canada's the place to be if you're trying to surf cancel culture and kind of survive it. You know, it's a tough one. I mean, I've run into sort of edges of it, but I think I'm putting together a little thesis on how you survive it, and you have to study the psychological mechanics, and just knowing what's going on means you don't necessarily have to learn it directly. So I studied psychopathy, and I studied sort of borderline behavior traits, and sort of how nations, you know, read Gulag Archipelago, you know, that can do all that stuff. So that when you find yourself in a situation that's like, people are like trying to figure out what side you're on, you know, you can just, did you know that this behavioral trait leads to this, and it's actually people who are, you know, people enjoy hurting other people. That's not healthy. You know, and they tend to take on these kinds of traits, and then that shuts it down. Now, I'm not saying it's the easiest way to get through, but I've managed to navigate, you know, because most of my views are like the wrong ones, you know, like when it comes to this mask stuff, it's like, you know, you got to be careful, though. I understand, especially public figures, you know, and we've been aware of that our whole lives. So anyway, let's talk about something else.
Yeah.
For a while. Okay. One of the things I really wanted to ask you, I mean, you're traveling with Jamie.
Excuse me. It's too many bubbles.
Okay. Tell me. You were traveling with Jamie Lahead across Canada doing some neat tours, and he's a fascinating fellow. And I just like this little story. You can comment on it if you want. It's just an observation, but I feel like there's so much magic in the world, and you get into a little routine, and it's easy to sort of forget that it's there. But he was describing traveling across Canada to these little gigs with you, and as a result, well, you have to stay somewhere every night. And in this one house, he was staying there, and it was like, yeah, there's three identical sisters, or three. Were you? Anyway, he just described sleeping on the couch in this one place, and it was like these three sort of witchy sisters in this high plains. It was just like grass fields and a house sticking out of the ground. I may be mapping a whole lot of stuff onto this, but the way he described it, I was like, how did this work? And he sort of gave me a little bit more detail, and I'd be like, this sounds like a grim fairy tale. You know, this sounds like it sounds like something that I would write. This doesn't sound like a real thing. And he's like, huh, because Jamie is very sort of like he's so in the moment that he's sort of, yeah, you're right. That was miraculous. I didn't think about it. I was just there.
Yeah.
You know, and I think when you're traveling, especially as a musician, you're living in this altered state. And I remember years ago, I remember having a conversation with you. You'd just come back from somewhere. And I think that level, I know it makes me a little, not crazy, but you have to function at a different level. Like, you're not connected to the root system. You're kind of, everybody you meet has to be, you're always on by default, and it kind of does something to you. And so you were very sort of, not manic, but you're in this sort of, you have to sort of stand back and watch it because it sparkles, but it's a type of madness. I call it travel madness, and artists kind of get it. Anyway, that's me babbling. What are your thoughts?
Wow. Well, I remember the earlier tours, because they were, later I learned how to pace it so that I can handle it. Mm. But like when Camille and I used to tour together, we were young, right? And we just tried to play as much as we could. So it was just like almost every night there was a gig. But a gig in the folk circuit in Canada means you're in, you know, maybe you play in a little theater, you play in a little cafe, or you play in someone's house or whatever. It can be anything. Mm-hmm. But you're generally being hosted. You know, it's not, they're not high paying shows, right? So, and somebody sort of takes you home or books the gig for you and provides an accommodation, maybe even a room like this beside a bar or something like that.
And so it's like, different every night, right?
It's different every night. And so many of those nights, people organize a party around you being there. So it's like this party for you every night for a year or something. It's like, it's too much. And so I remember being, after I think one of these tours was about 10 months, we went from Newfoundland, we were living in Newfoundland, Camille and I at the time, and we went all the way to BC and then all the way back. And it took about 10 months because, you know, we're playing all the time, all the way there and back, whatever. We had a band, there was four of us in the band. We became very tight, of course, like very intense. I mean, Camille, I think it was Camille who had a dream. When she woke up, she was like, I had a dream, we all had the same nose, except for that it was like, someone had, his nose was plugged and then none of us could breathe because I was just like, yeah, I get that. Like, that's what it feels like. Like, we're like this one person, but we're four. But the weird thing for me was that I realized that I was on such a weird automatic, because every night at party for me, every night everybody's asking you the same question. So what do you get into music? Or so what inspired this song? Or so how did you grow up? Or how many, whatever, like weird questions people up. But it would end up being the same questions every day. So there was a sort of automatic story of me that I could tell, and I could be sort of charming about it. Or eventually I started getting very bored with it, but I'd still try and be like, respect to the person who I just met, you know, like they want to know something and I wanted to be able to share it. And at the end I was like, I'm so burned out, I can't talk to anyone. I had to go, we got back to Newfoundland and we just all went into this almost depression of just not being able to talk. And I was like, I can't talk about myself again for a very long time. I almost have to change myself. Actually, that's when I went to university, probably. It was after that tour, because I had burnt out so much on the expression of like whatever identity I'd created for me, which I didn't even know I was creating an identity. But when you're asked constantly, you're, every time you're telling a story, basically, and the same story over and over and over. Whew. Anyway, yeah. Now I haven't done that kind of intensity of a tour, but yeah, some of the ones with Jamie were pretty intense.
That was a short little thing with what, only 30 dates or something like this, or
how many?
30.
Yeah, maybe it was like,
it seemed like he would describe, oh, it's just a nice little, it'll be a fun
30
summer.
Dates is a fair amount of doing that. I mean, now
it's not 10 months of
it's not, but that's what I sort of realized. We got to chop it up. And actually, that was, I was so grateful that Jamie came with me on those trips. He was so great to tour with. I mean, he's such a great person, and he's just like, helpful and fun and really into the music.
He's supportive and kind, and when you're around him, his energy just settles things. You know, and if your natural state is up here, he's gonna just, it's like a, you know, a kite string, and he's always like, yeah, come on back. Oh, it's good, it's fine, let's go find somewhere to sleep. Are you hungry? Like, just
fun. Oh, he was great. But anyway, so I kind of learned. I mean, I paced myself, but I think the thing that used to stress me out, and this is another one of those sort of spiritual journey development thing, because so many incredible things would happen and I would forget them, and I would like be like, even in the moment, I know that this is like the highest point of my life, and I'm probably not going to remember it, because later, you know, another one and then another one. And so at some point, all of the sort of high moments become this fuzz of vague faces and forms, and I don't really know what happened anymore. And I have a very bad memory. Probably Jamie remembers every detail because he has that kind of mind. Yeah. He remembers song lyrics from 1,000 songs. I don't know. I don't have that kind of brain. I can't remember stuff.
Yeah, he's remarkable that way.
And I used to sort of beat myself up a little bit because I would forget a person, even a person we'd had these great moments with, you know? Mm-hmm. And then I think I was on a beach in India and I'd been doing some sort of meditation work or whatever. And I was reading Krishnamurti. Do you know Krishnamurti?
No.
Amazing.
Okay.
So Krishnamurti is sort of a spiritual teacher. His whole story is incredible. And it's worth looking up actually, because I don't know. I'll just tell you what he said in the book. Right. So I just opened the book sort of randomly to a middle page, and it was talking about memory and how memory, although it's a very praised, thing, like if somebody with a good memory is considered smart, like you can remember stuff, you're smart. Right, that's your basic schooling or whatever. But he was saying about if you remember good things, your comparison mind is like you're comparing a great memory to this moment, like that was a greater moment. So it kind of brings almost a nostalgia or sadness about what we're experiencing now. Huh. Because I can remember, another interview I did that was
yeah.
No, couldn't be better than this, but what I mean. Later when I'm doing worse interviews, I'll be like, oh, that one with the money. No, but anyway, but so he's like, if you're remembering positive things from the like a former party you were at, it's going to make this party feel a little less fun because you're in this comparison, right? Uh-huh. Where if you remember a really bad party from before, you're like re-experiencing the pain, so you're also like bringing yourself down. So basically his point was like anytime you're remembering something, you are dimming this present moment, like you're not here, you're actually causing a kind of lower vibration. He didn't say lower vibration, he doesn't talk like that, he's very clear. I can't actually repeat the way he speaks, but it's amazing.
That's fascinating.
Well, it was so good for me because I had a very severe concussion when I was 20, like a massive head injury.
Oh, is that right?
Took me, I don't know, I mean, it was like it took me months and months to be able to like think clearly. Okay. Like it was one of those things, probably a year before I was really back to being able to function, but with always the awareness, even this is like 20 years later, with always the awareness that I don't function mentally the same way I did before that thing. And I would sort of hurt myself about it, like I'd be sad about it. But reading that, somehow it was like in this instant, I was like, oh yeah, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter every detail, like somebody's name, the experience we had, that I remember everything about it. Because I do have a very kind of sharp intuition about whether something is a positive force or not in my life, sure. And if I see someone and I'm like, yeah, we had great times, I don't remember anything about it, but I know it was great. I know you're great or whatever. That is actually so much more fulfilling and rewarding than remembering everything we did before and be like, well, what happened now? Like, why aren't you that great this time? Right? Because last time it was we had this amazing moment. Like if you're always comparing your life to whether it's good or bad.
Interesting. It's almost like you're going through the patterns of multiple lives in one life. Because like all the people that are really, really special to me, I believe that we've had multiple incarnations, and you've been that person's parent, you've been that person's lover, you've been that person's child, you've been that person's good friend or warrior, or enemy, whatever. And you don't remember any of that. But when you meet them, you're like, right?
Yeah.
And then you get to have a new experience without any of that baggage.
Exactly. Yeah. And that is that's the true like soul connect. That's the beauty. And I think you can look for that now. We don't have to remember what the last conversation was or what the last story was or whatever.
I was reading something about, there was this woman who did the meditative steps necessary to have a flood of memory from multiple past lives. And it was just like, I don't think I want to do that to myself, because it was all the most intense memories come first. Well, which ones are those? Well, it's the one where you killed someone on a battlefield, or they killed you. The horrible, painful ones. And she just was like, the way she went through it was just a couple of hours of just her crying, just remembering image, unstoppable, like just like horrible thing that she had done to someone else.
Ouch.
And all the way through was this voice like, you didn't know, right? It's just. And it was very cleansing, right? But it just sounded like, there's a reason we forget, because you can't do your life this time if you're hauling all that stuff around you. So you just trust the intuition that handles all that stuff for you, right? Yeah. Anyway.
Wow.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
And even that stuff, like whether
I mean, you've studied a culture that, I mean, you know, in the broad sense, believes in reincarnation. But like, what are your thoughts, having moved through
what
that?
What did you just say about a culture that believes in reincarnation?
Well, you know,
I missed the beginning of that sentence.
If you're in India, isn't that sort of one of the bases of their, you know, of one of the major
It's not,
regions?
Yeah, it's not a, do you believe in reincarnation?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's more like the way you just described it when you're talking about past life, I think. Well, it's a little bit. My mother and I snuck off. I remember to do a past life regression when I was a teenager.
Oh boy. How did that go?
Well, my grandmother would not have approved. That's why we had to sneak off. And I thought that was pretty hilarious at the time. I was about 14 or 15. And it was one of those things, like everybody put a mat down and lay down. And I don't know where she was from, but she was quite known in the realm of being able to guide people back into their past lives to experience that or remember or whatever. So we did this. And yeah, it was pretty intense. And I did remember.
Oh boy.
I remembered a death. I remembered a battlefield. Stuff very much rooted actually to this land, but long before, you know, the settlers and all that came. And that memory has somehow informed my life on some levels. Like there was something in it that I was like, oh yeah, you know, that makes sense. On the other hand, I wasn't sure even if I was making it up at the time or not making it up at the time, because, you know, I was also very young and still am quite impressionable.
Yeah, you're still forming. How old were you? You were 16?
14. 14. 16. That's 14. Little, something like that.
You're too young for that sort of thing, yeah.
Yeah, well, not really, because, you know, you can kind of, you can just be open at any point.
You got through it, yeah.
Yeah, you know, it wasn't so rock in my world in that way. Although there's been a lot of people in my life that have talked about, and you like about your past life. So some of the astrology, and in particular Vedic astrology, talks about past lives and looks into that. And it's always kind of had this ring of truth. But even in my life, I feel like it. I feel like I know past versions of myself.
Sure.
And whether that's past versions of myself or some kind of, you know, intuition of the collective consciousness or, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not too worried about the specifics of reincarnation. But I do feel that there's something there.
It's useful to understand that's how things work, because then you're not sort of stuck in this linear, like,
this is
everything's material
is.
And then you have the end and that's over. I mean, the kinds of decisions you make when that's your belief system are going to be very different from ones where you believe, oh, you're kind of an infinite being and you've...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the infinite being and the oneness and that we are all really... I mean, I feel that we are all one thing.
You know, you're me sitting over there and I'm you sitting over here at different points in the vast timeline that we're all part of. Yeah.
Yeah. And that everything... I mean, that's why the whole idea of competition is so ridiculous to me. It's like... I win, you win. Like, what's the difference? I'm a superstar or you're a superstar. It's like, I still get to be a superstar if you're a superstar.
Yeah.
I mean, it exists. And so it's part of the thing that we all are.
Yeah.
If that's, I mean, it's not actually.
But some types of competition are perfect. Like they're exactly, like if your basketball isn't any fun, you know, if the other team isn't trying their best, you know.
Exactly.
But it's
energy. It's just like an energy exchange. And that's enjoyable.
Yeah.
Like that's part of what we're here to do is like.
But I remember I was doing I came across a book and I was fascinated by about past life regression. And I was like, oh, these are the exercises. And I was going through them.
Oh, wow.
And then at one point I hit this neat point and I got this very strong. It was like, ugh. And it was like, are you sure? Because you can. All right, think about this. You know,
like, are you sure you want to go further?
Yeah. Are you sure you want that page to open up? And I was like, actually, no. I'm perfectly content. And there's like, and everything just sort of settled. It was like, huh, I find I do that. I get right to
me
the limit.
Me too. Me too. I remember actually also as a young person, maybe a kid, hearing a guy talking about ghosts, because he could see ghosts and he had all these experiences of seeing ghosts, like actual, like, you know, in their clothes. Like he was describing seeing a person, you know, in her olden days clothes and like the whole thing, like whatever. And different houses he moved in and how he was somebody who was asked to go in and clear out energies or whatever. I don't remember his whole story because I was pretty young. But one thing that struck me, because he said, yeah, you can see ghosts if you want to. I mean, it's not that, it's just like opening that channel for yourself. He said, but you also don't have to. Like, you can close that that ability to take in that frequency. And I remember as a kid being like, it would be kind of cool, but there's enough people here already. Like, I'm going to close those doors.
Yeah.
And I'm making a conscious effort not to be like on that level of, you know, psychic or intuitive or whatever it is. So there is something, and it's something I've noticed even, you know, in growing with people, because I used to have almost no boundaries with people. Like, I feel like that was my, I mean, a very like open-hearted, open door kind of family and upbringing and everything, and you know, love everybody equally and all that stuff like made sense to me as a kid and still does. But loving everybody doesn't mean you have to let them all kind of in and let every energy in. And for me, that took me a long time to know. And I think that learning that kind of boundary, but still in a loving way, because it's not that you don't care about somebody because you don't let them like be all like their energy all over you, all over yours. Because sometimes
I've run into copies. Like, I feel like, the way I look at it is that one soul is too big for one body, and so it gets sort of subdivided. And so you've got multiple copies of yourself experiencing, you know, this version of you is in, you know, there's a version of Sahara out there who's a computer programmer because she's just really interested in that, is really good at it. And there's a musical rhythm to the numbers, but you can't do that and this at the same time. So boop, there's two of them. There might be a dozen, or I don't know what the numbers are, but there is a physics to it, I do believe. Wow. Anyway, every now and then I'll run into, oh, it's my good friend in this version, and whatever he's going through in this life is so dark and so painful. I've actually said, you know what, I can't. I put walls up between people I know I love,
mm-hmm.
and that sucks. But at the same time, like, I can't let it in. I've got my own shit to do, you know. Mm-hmm. I can't take it on. But I've done that a few times, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and it's sort of similar. I mean, whether somebody's dead or alive.
Yeah.
you do get to choose, I guess.
Yeah. You know. Oh, okay. How are we doing? What kind of time? 2 hours?
Yeah.
Do you wanna think about wrapping this up?
Sure. That was really fun.
That was nice.
Nice to talk to you always.
Yeah, this is exactly what I was hoping for. Yeah. If we do get a chance to get you in again, love you to bring some musical instruments.
Definitely.
And we'll mic the place so you sound perfect.
Okay.
And that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you for tuning in, everyone. Do the like and subscribe thing, even though it doesn't mean a lot. It doesn't matter to us, but it was a real pleasure talking to Sahara, and I hope you tune in again for another one of these little interviews. So love you all from the valley. Take care, guys.